Hey, Harvest.
Welcome to church.
So glad you joined us this weekend.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to Harvest. We're so glad you're here.
Hi, and welcome to Harvest Bible Chat. We're so glad that you can join us this weekend. Even though we're not meeting together physically, we're going to have a great time of worship and time of studying God's Word.
Hey, it's so good to see you.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Harvest. Come on in.
Hello, church family. Welcome to Harvest. We're so happy that you're here tonight. We hope you enjoy the service.
Welcome to Harvest. We're so excited you decided to join us today, and we can't wait to see what God has in store.
Hi, everyone. So excited you're able to join us this weekend for the service. I hope you're as excited as I am to worship the Lord and to dive into His Word. Welcome.
Welcome to Church Harvest. Glad to see you this morning. Hope you enjoy your day.
Hi, church family. Welcome to Harvest. We're happy that you're here tonight.
Welcome, Harvest. We're so excited to have you with us here at our service this weekend.
Hello, welcome to Harvest. We're glad you are here. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome.
We welcome you to online church. We're so excited you can be here. When the Lord left, He promised that He would send His Spirit, and His Spirit is what lives in us. And when it is among us, it has the power to change lives. It has the power to change you and me, wherever you are, even in your living rooms. So as we sing today, just invite His Spirit to be with you in this time and just to move in you however He needs. So as we sing,
yes. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only wanna hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we want to know you more and more. We're hanging on every word. Cause when you speak and when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we see. Everything else can wait. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, come now and breathe upon our hearts. Come now and have your way. Cause when you speak and when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what changes what we see and what we seek. You're changing everything, Lord.
God of the rescue, God of the breakthrough, how great is your faithfulness, right? You're not done yet. No eye has seen, no eye has ever seen, no ear has ever heard, no one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough, your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. You're not done yet. No, no, no. God in my Savior, God in my dream, you put a song in my soul. God in the Word, oh God, I'm believing, you'll do the impossible.
That's right. God is still moving mountains. He's still breaking chains. It's happening. It's happening. He's still at work. So let's just watch this testimony of just that right now.
Hey, Harvest. Andy here. Hey, this is a bit of a unique God at work story this weekend. But Kyle Smith joined me online, and we got to talk to Johnny and Larissa Griffin. They're a beloved family from our Rolling Meadows campus. I've known Johnny for probably 10 years now. They are a family of four, and their youngest son, Caden, was born last July. He was due in October. And overall, they spent over 200 days in the NICU with Caden. So the first question I asked Johnny was, what happened with Caden? Why did they spend so much time in hospital?
Well, he was born, like you said, July 3rd. He was due in October. So he was born at 24 weeks, and obviously, when you're born that early, that comes with some complications. So he had premature lungs. He had a lot of stenosis in his airway and a host of other issues. And so that ultimately is what led to him being in the hospital for over 200 days.
So we were on a Zoom call together with some of the other married small groups from our campus, and we talked just a little bit about this. But after spending about 8 months in the NICU with your son, Caden, how have you seen God show up in your marriage, and how have you seen him provide for you both during this time?
that sometimes when we go through things, I always find comfort in knowing that He's going to use any and everything for our good. Nothing is in vain. So when we were going through what we were going through, He would always say that He's going to use it for our good. I don't know how, and I can't see just yet, but He's going to use it for our good. And so countless times in the past, throughout our marriage history, when we got to this point in our marriage, you would think that trials around us with what we were going through would equate to it being a winter season in our marriage. But I think what the Lord did was help us to come together and draw closer even more, and build a solid foundation on Him, so that when these storms and these trials come, we know who our Savior is. We know who will redeem us and use it for our good. And so during that time, it strengthened our marriage. It made us closer together. It made us closer with the Lord. And then that spilled out to other marriages around us who may have been in winter seasons in and out. It just enabled us to say, hey, you can get through this. If we can get through this, you can get through this.
So Cadence in the hospital for all that time, then eventually gets released February 25th of this year, praise God. But then March 13th comes and the pandemic hits. Johnny and Larissa are both independent business owners. Larissa is a bookkeeper, and she was able to keep some of that business going while still coming back and forth from the hospital. But Johnny runs a hair salon, and that all had to shut down. So did God create an opportunity from that? Johnny explains.
Man, I think going through what we went through with Caden really kind of was like, I guess, like training camp to what we had to go through during the pandemic. Because I'm telling you, when when this happened, when they shut us down, I mean, it was like, man, I can't believe they shut down my shop. But it was like, well, at least we're at home together, you know? And it's like our whole attitude was just completely different. And I think the Lord used what we just went through as a precursor to what you're going to have to go through and get through. And so when I tell you God provided in ways that only he can do, we haven't missed a meal. We haven't missed a bill. Yeah. God is faithful. And He's just provided this entire time. I can't really explain it, to be honest with you. To go 2.5 months with no income, my business was completely shut down. There's no other way to explain that outside of God sustaining us and making a way out of no way.
Yeah. Wow. There's that scripture that says He will keep you in perfect peace if your mind is stayed on Him. And that's
been our scripture.
That's been our solid place. He has kept us in peace, and He will give us a peace that surpasses all understanding. So you would think with all of what we faced would be another reason to just crumble. And He gave us such a sense of peace and contentment to just be together and to be at home. And we just do not worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Today is enough for today. We just were thankful. We just ushered in a thankful and grateful heart every day, and He took care of the rest. Seek Him first, and that's exactly what He did for us.
Wow, what a testimony of God's provision, of people sticking it out with God and just following Him through the valley. Like she said, Isaiah 26 verse 3, you keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts you. So I asked the Griffins, how can we pray for you as a church?
You guys can just pray for Caden.
Yes.
Pray for Caden. Pray that he continues to grow and be strong and be all who the Lord has called him to be. Pray for our marriage. Pray that we continue to stand on the rock of Christ and continue to give His name glory, you know, daily through our marriage. And I can go on and on. I can go on and on. I pray for the businesses. We're going to open back up. You know what I'm saying?
So church, let's pray for the Griffins in these days ahead. Let's write their name on a card and put it on our fridge or the dashboard of our car, and remind ourselves to pray for them as a church, but also as a reminder of the hundreds of stories of God's faithfulness and God at work in the lives of people within our church, adding to the story of redemption, Jesus Christ, the cornerstone. Let's worship Him.
see him there. The great I am, a crown of thorns upon his head. The Father's heart displayed for us. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. Lifted up on Calvary's hill, we cursed your name, and even still, you bore our shame and paid the cost. Oh God, we thank you for the cross. We thank you, God. And behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. Oh, we sing your praise, endless hallelujahs to your holy name. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. For every sin, our Savior died, the Lord of life. He can't be contained. Our God has risen from the grave.
Sing to him in your living room right now. Lift it up.
Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written.
We sing your praise. We sing to the name above all names, the one seated on the throne, high and lifted up, the God who is holy, immovable, unshakable, worthy of our praise, worthy of our affection. God, that's what we give you today. we behold the Lamb that was slain for our sins in our place. And we give you worship, God. You're worthy today, God. We bless your name wherever we are, Lord. We sing your praise, for you are good, and we're thankful for all you've done for us, God. We love you, Jesus, and it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
I love that truth that during these times, Jesus reigns forevermore. Well, hello, Harvest. My name is John Smith, and I serve as a co-campus pastor at a Rolling Meadows campus. I'm so glad you joined us today online. Well, I'd like to take a few moments and just share with you some ways that you can stay connected here at Harvest. First, whether you call Harvest your church home or you're a guest with us today, I'd like to invite you to go to the top of the page if you're on our website and just check in. If you have your phone nearby, you can pick that up, open that, look for the app, and let us know that you are here today. It gives you an opportunity to let us know how we might be able to care for you. Well, one of the questions that I get during this time is, how can I get connected at Harvest? And one of the answers I share with people is, our small groups are amazing. It's an opportunity for us to experience community. Yeah, I know it's a little different during this time being online, but Sherry and I are so refreshed every week when we get an opportunity to meet with our small group online. We get to connect about what's going on in life. We get to encourage one another as we spend time in the Word and look for practical ways to grow in our walk with the Lord. It's an opportunity for us to pray with each other and to have some authentic accountability. So I would say, if you haven't checked out our small groups, or you're looking to get back into a small group, let us know. We'd love to get you connected this week. Go to harvestbiblechapel.org/small groups. Well, hey, men, I am sure you've heard by now, there is this event planned just for you. It's for all of us men. It's called Man of the House. Just hearing about it, I got so fired up, I ran out to the garage, and I'm like, I gotta put up my tent now. What do you think? Looks pretty good here in our family room. I gotta tell you, I'm excited about this event. It's taking place on Friday, June 12th, and Saturday, June 13th. That tent's gonna look way better in the backyard. And so, hey, this event, it's free. It's online. You can invite a few friends over to your house, keep socially distanced in your backyard. Maybe you can even grill out and then turn the sessions online and watch them together. Pastor Tommy is going to be bringing the word to us about purity. Pastor Britt is going to be bringing the word to us about what does the Bible say about anxiety. And Pastor Jeff is going to be wrapping it up with a message on relational conflict and how to handle it. So whether you live in Arlington Heights or you live in Arlington, Texas, you can be a part of this event. So go register online. It's at harvestbiblechapel.org/man of the house. So don't miss this. It's going to be great. Probably time for me to get this tent out of our family room. Wow, change is happening every day. And some of that change has been for the better. Some of the change has totally caught us off guard. We might find ourselves in a very different place from 30, 60, or 90 days ago because maybe you've been furloughed, maybe your hours have been cut, or maybe you've lost your job. Well, church family, we want to care for you. So if you would go to our website, you will find there some practical ways that we can help care for you and even give you some financial encouragement. Hey, small business owners, thank you so much for taking the time to register your company. We believe that it's been an encouragement to you, and it's also been an encouragement to so many of our families looking to get help during these times. And so it's not too late to register your company. Go today onto the website, register your company. We believe it'll be helpful for you and our church. Well, clarity is key during times like this. Things are changing by the moment, and our church leadership wants to keep you informed with coronavirus updates. And so why don't you go to our church website and find out the latest information? Well, Harvest, it has been amazing to see what God has been doing in our church. And one of the ways that we have seen God's faithfulness is through your generosity, through the way that you have been caring for the needs of the people in our church. And I'm so thankful for the ways that the Lord has increased that spirit inside of our church. And I just want to remind you of the ways that you can give. There's a couple different ways. One, you can give today through the website, or you can text in your gift, or you can use your Harvest app and give through that. Or if you choose to give by mail, just mail it into our Rolling Meadows campus. So let me lead us in a word of prayer right now. Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much for being with us in these changing times. You are faithful. You are good. You are righteous. You are our provider. You are our sustainer. You've been here in times for our church and for our very personal needs. You are our refuge. You are our strength. And we never want to take that for granted. And Father, in these times of unrest in our country, would you help us as a church to love one another? Would you help us as a church to care for one another inside our church and outside of our church? Lord, thank you for the way that you have been providing all of our needs. You are good. And now as we take a moment and just express our gratefulness, would you find our hearts full of joy? Would you find our hearts in a place of generosity? Lord, we want these gifts to be used to bring yourself glory. We want people to be drawn to you, for you are so good and we love you. And this is just a little expression of our love to you today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Darkness tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken.
All right, come on.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, well, shame no longer has a place to hide. Captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. Oh, I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand. Stand a chance when I stand in your love.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm
Church, I want to welcome you to week 4 of our series, Just Jesus, Bold Servant. So open your Bible to Mark chapter 11. As we get started today, I'd like for us to read the entire passage we're studying together. So let's begin in verse 27 of Mark chapter 11. And they came again to Jerusalem. And as he was walking in the temple, the chief priests and the scribes and the elders came to him. And they said to him, by what authority are you doing these things, or who gave you this authority to do them? Jesus said to them, I will ask you one question. Answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Was the baptism of John from heaven or from man? Answer me. And they discussed it with one another, saying, if we say from heaven, he will say, why then did you not believe him? But shall we say from man? They were afraid of the people, for they all held that John really was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And Jesus said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. And he began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a pit for the winepress and built a tower and leased it to tenants and went into another country. So when the season came, he sent a servant to the tenants to get from them some of the fruit of the vineyard. And they took him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. Again, he sent to them another servant, and they struck him on the head and treated him shamefully. And he sent another, and him they killed. And so with many others, some they beat and some they killed. He had still one other, a beloved son. Finally, he sent him to them, saying, they will respect my son. But those tenants said to one another, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. And they took him and killed him and threw him out of the vineyard. What will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyard to others. Have you not read this scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. And they were seeking to arrest him, but feared the people, for they perceived that he had told the parable against them. So they left him and went away. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you today, asking that you would help us really dive into this passage and that it would just come alive for us. Help us have a sense of what it would have been like to be there, witnessing Jesus and these religious leaders having this conversation. We're thankful that your word is living and active, and we want to hear from you today, and we want to apply the things that we can learn out of this passage, Lord. Come have your way. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. All right, well, I'm not sure how many of you are really into movies, but I've always loved movies. I remember watching my first movie in the theater when I was about 9 years old, and I grew up asking my parents for 1 year's worth of Disney Channel on our cable package as a birthday present, because we had a satellite dish on our roof, and it was huge. It was like 10 foot in diameter, and the way it worked is you would push fav and then a number, like fav, five, enter. And what would happen next is you would hear on the roof, literally the dish would move to point towards a different satellite, and then you get like another 20 channels. And when you'd come up to the Disney Channel, it was a black screen, and it said, call this number if you would like to purchase the Disney Channel. But we also knew that you could push the button preview on the remote, and if you did that, you'd get 5 seconds of the Disney Channel, and then on the lower third, there'd be like a black bar, and it said, if you'd like to purchase, call this number. So what'd we do? We took turns, and we would push that preview button every 5 seconds. And we watched entire movies and shows by just taking turns pushing that preview button, and we'd run the batteries dry on all our remotes because we kept on doing that. And the reason we would do that was because we loved those 90s Disney Channel movies with all that bad acting and cheesy storylines. We ate those movies up. But whether you're into movies or not, you will notice that a lot of them fall into a similar big picture structure. In academia, this is referred to as the classical three-act structure. Basically, it shows that a lot of movies start with establishing a context, then a problem is presented, and then a journey begins for someone. And once the journey is complete, a new reality is formed. Now, I know these movies aren't talking about Jesus, but I love seeing the universal principle of there being a problem in our reality as something that needs to be solved. It's describing what Solomon says in Ecclesiastes 3:11, where he says that God has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity into man's heart. Every human heart knows that there is more out there than just what we see with our eyes. And this might sound a bit weird to some of you, but watching a great movie, I don't mean just a good one, I mean like a great one, it stirs my affection for Jesus. Because if my heart is stirred by a fictional story or a fictional portrayal of a story, then I leave with a huge sense of gratitude towards God that his story of redemption is real. And here in Mark 11 and 12, we're jumping into the heat of the tension between Jesus and the religious leaders in this true journey towards redemption. Last week, we talked about how Jesus gave a symbolic picture of their judgment with the fig tree, and then he enacted that judgment by shutting it down. And now we continue in that conflict, that journey that will lead to Jesus being murdered. But before we get there, we see here that the tension is rising. What is coming to a head is a clash of authorities. The religious leaders have a man coming into the temple who has performed so many miracles in front of so many witnesses that it's impossible to call him a crazy person. So they are cornered into having to have an opinion on whether or not this man is a prophet from God or a false prophet who would need to be killed according to the law. Can you feel it? The tension is rising. I think the best way I can represent what's happening in this passage is to continue last week's outline and adding two more movements today. So last week we had movements 1 through 3, which were the fig tree, the temple, and faith in God. And this week I'm going to start with a teaching point on verse 26 because, as you may have noticed, it's not there. Then I'm going to give you movements 4 and 5 as the tension is rising. Think of this weekend's sermon as the sequel to last week's. So we begin today with this topic of why verse 26 is gone from most of our translations. Now, I could have just as easily skipped over it, but one of the reasons I really believe in expository preaching is because it helps me deal with the passage right in front of me rather than just choosing what I would prefer to preach. This topic is something I'm very, very passionate about personally, because I have seen how in the past 20 years there has been a real attack on people's trust in the Bible, and it needs to be addressed. I remember being in high school and asking my Bible class teachers, how do we know that we have the right books in the Bible? Or how do we know which manuscripts are most accurate? And my teachers did their best to try and help me with that question, but the best answer I could get was that I was supposed to trust that God had preserved the Bible. And I did. And I still do, but my heart wasn't at rest. And even in college, I would face some of these questions with my friends and didn't end up with a better answer. Then what happened to some of my friends after college, I never expected. I thought the more years we lived, the closer to Jesus we would all be. They grew up in Christian families like me. They went to Christian colleges like me. But now some of them have walked away from the Lord. And I've wept over this with the Lord. And as I've continued to talk with them, it's clear that it all started with them walking away from believing the Bible. See, this tactic of the enemy is by no means new. What was his first play out of the playbook in the Garden of Eden? He feeds Eve that sinister line that has been proven effective for millennia now. He says, "Did God actually say that?" If Satan can get you to doubt what God has said, then he's happy to leave you hopelessly wandering in life, looking for a compass to point you north. In recent years, some authors and academic scholars have made claims that there are 400,000 errors in the New Testament. And that's more words than there are in the New Testament. And sure, it's an academically polished version of this tactic, but it's still the same question. Did God actually say that? These claims are severely misleading because they begin with a conclusion in mind. That snake talking to Eve that day in the garden knew what God had said, but his goal was to get Eve to disobey God. And step one of that plan is to get her to doubt that God even said it. This is worth me taking the time to explain because for some of you, you see that verse 26 isn't in your translation and it can cause you to start losing confidence in the book you hold in your hands. And what follows after that loss of confidence is nothing but destruction and pain for your soul. I've seen it happen, and I don't want it to happen to you. And in an effort to not spend 3 hours talking about this today, here are the key points I want to share with you. Textual criticism is the study of a literary work that aims to establish the original text. And it's a very refined study. It's a lot like how scientists over the past 1,600 years have continued to find smaller particles in the composition of matter. We used to think that the atom was the smallest particle in the universe, only to find out that there are subatomic particles in each atom called protons, neutrons, and electrons. Only to find out that those subatomic particles can be divided into quarks. Nothing has actually changed in the composition of matter, but as time has progressed, our ability to zoom in further has also progressed. That's what's happening in textual criticism. Our early English translations, for example, the original King James Version, were created with only a handful of manuscripts because it was the best we had at the time. Since then, with archaeological and technological advancements, we now have, get this, 5,900 Greek manuscripts available. All the modern translations of the Bible now use those 5,900 manuscripts to get a very fine-tuned sense of what the original books of the Bible said. Let me remind you that God chose to reveal the Bible in a time where these books were written in biodegradable papyrus, necessitating many copies to be made to preserve its message. There wasn't a chemical they could spray on those scrolls to preserve an original scroll up until today. And so, scribes are tasked with the purpose of creating these copies by hand. And bottom line, the scribes aren't perfect at what they did. And when there's a difference between manuscripts, that's called a variant. And here's the most important thing for you to know. Absolutely none of the variants between the manuscripts hold any significant theological doctrine. This is truly the miracle. There's nothing even close to it when comparing the Bible to other ancient documents. And think about how much variance there is between churches and leaders on the doctrines of the Bible, how to interpret the Bible, what it says. There's a whole lot of that. But how amazing is it that when it comes to knowing what the original text says, we have vast agreement across those devoting themselves to the study of textual criticism. Even an atheist scholar who is a textual critic of the Bible admits that these variants don't change the message of the Bible. He's simply choosing not to believe it. He says, and I quote, this is the same guy who says there's 400,000 errors. He says, "The essential Christian beliefs are not affected by textual variants." What's in conflict here is not textual criticism, it's the willingness of man's heart to believe the things that God, in fact, did say. And if you're like me, you might wonder if there are still some undiscovered manuscripts out there that will give us an even more fine-tuned text of the Bible. But here's the thing. When we went from a handful of manuscripts to thousands, the message of the Bible did not change. So what's most intellectually responsible and rational is to believe that if we add another 5,000 manuscripts to our total list, then the meaning of the Bible won't change then either. You can trust what you have in your hands. The reason verse 26 isn't in your copy of the Bible, unless you're reading from the KJV, is for two reasons. The first reason is because this verse is missing from most of the Greek manuscripts and doesn't appear until the later manuscripts. So the closer we are to the date of the original, naturally, the more accurate it will be. And the second reason is that this verse seems to be a reassimilation of Matthew 6:15. So the combination of it not being in most of the manuscripts and the fact that it's very similar to Matthew 6:15 leads us to the conclusion that it was added by scribes in the medieval manuscripts to help clarify the point of the previous verse. Again, this verse contains a true statement since it comes from the book of Matthew, but it's most accurate to conclude it's not part of the original writing of the book of Mark. The message of the Bible is not what's being debated. The willingness to believe the message of the Bible is what's being debated. And manipulating data in order to confuse people into losing trust in the Bible is being fueled by man's desire not to have to live according to the Bible, so that they can be their own God. But you need to know that what you hold in your hands is the revelation of God to humanity through the inspired writing of human authors. And I stand in front of you today giving testimony that if you believe the accuracy of the Bible, you will get to live the accuracy of the Bible. You get to put it into practice and do what it says. And before your very eyes, you will see just how accurate it truly is. So thanks for sticking with me as we walk through that. I care very, very deeply about your confidence in the Word of God. And here, as we continue in verse 27 of Mark chapter 11, the leaders aren't questioning what Jesus did or said. They're questioning where his authority comes from. It's a trap they're setting up for him, but it's not going to go so good for them. So here it is, movement 4, the trap challenging Jesus' authority. Verse 27 says, "And they came again to Jerusalem. And as he was walking in the temple, the chief priests and the scribes and the elders came to him. And they said to him, 'By what authority are you doing these things? Or who gave you this authority to do them?'" These leaders are asking Jesus about his authority. And in the book of Mark, the topic of authority refers to divinely given authority to cast out demons and to forgive people of their sins. We've been seeing questions about Jesus' authority as early as Mark chapter 3. And here, the leaders come up with what I'm sure they thought was a clever trap. And we know this conversation is happening in front of a crowd because you'll see later that the leaders are nervous about how the crowd is going to react. So clearly, there's people around witnessing this interaction. Their trap is this: if Jesus claims that he and God share the same authority, then they would accuse him of blasphemy. But if he claims it's strictly his own authority, then they can condemn him for shutting down the temple on the basis of human authority. Seems like the perfect trap, right? They got him now. Well, you can't trap him who confounds the wise and makes them a fool. And Jesus answers this question with a counter question. This was a very common way rabbis would teach, and it was often a way Jesus answered questions. So let's see what he says. Verse 29. Jesus said to them, "I will ask you one question. Answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Was the baptism of John from heaven," meaning from God, "or from man? Answer me." Now, I know it kind of looks like Jesus is changing the topic, but what you have to realize is the genius of this question. If the leaders answer Jesus correctly, then they will have the answer to their own question. But they have to answer in order to get Jesus to answer their question. Jesus is clearly in control of the situation. He's not taking the backseat. He's leading the conversation because the tension is rising. And Jesus's question is to answer if John the Baptist's authority came from God or man. The phrase "the baptism of John" in this verse is just shorthand referring to the ministry of John the Baptist. John the Baptist is a prophet sent by God who testified regarding Jesus. And if they would have accepted John's ministry as from God, then they would have accepted the ministry of Jesus. So it's obvious these leaders don't think much about John the Baptist. Continuing in verse 31, and they discussed it with one another, saying, if we say from heaven, he will say, why then did you not believe him? But shall we say from man? They were afraid of the people, for they all held that John really was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And Jesus said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. This trap that they set up has backfired completely on them. And now if they say that John's authority came from God, then the obvious problem is, well, then why didn't you believe John? And if they say it wasn't from God, then they're going to have a serious crowd control problem because the people accepted John as a prophet from God. If the only thing you're thinking about as a leader in any given decision is crowd management, then you're probably not in a great place. What about the truth? What about the many ways that Jesus showed them his authority had come from God? They can't see what's in plain sight. So they bail on their question altogether and say that they don't know. By not knowing the answer to that, they've revealed just how weak they had become as leaders. How is it possible that they don't even know if John the Baptist was a prophet from God? That was literally their job as religious leaders. Well, Jesus tells them he doesn't even have to answer their question because they clearly don't have the ability to discern where Jesus' spiritual authority is coming from anyways. And I gotta say, if Jesus was competing in a debate, then he'd be walking away with a gold medal around his neck right now. But he's not even done with the religious leaders yet. And that gets us to movement 5, the rebuttal, a parable of injustice. Here, Jesus is going to tell a parable where the meaning is going to be so obvious that those religious leaders are going to figure it out without Jesus explaining it. Chapter 12, verse 1 says this, and he began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a pit for the winepress and built a tower and leased it to tenants and went into another country. When the season came, he sent a servant to the tenants to get from them some of the fruit of the vineyard. And they took him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. Again, he sent to them another servant, and they struck him on the head and treated him shamefully. And he sent another, and him they killed. And so with many others, some they beat and some they killed. The vineyard here in this parable is the entire nation of Israel. It's God's chosen people. This picture is frequently used in the Old Testament to represent Israel. And God is the owner of this vineyard. He's the one who sets the fence around it and digs the wine press and builds that watchtower to protect it. This shows us the considerable effort God has shown in choosing and blessing Israel. They had everything they needed to bear much spiritual fruit. But the tenants are these religious leaders that Jesus is confronting. And they're the ones who have been beating God's servants for a long time. The servants in this parable are symbolic of the prophets that God had sent to call the people of Israel back to covenant faithfulness to God. Often in the Old Testament, the prophets were referred to by God as my servants, the prophets. And these leaders are beating, rejecting, and killing the servants that God, the owner, is sending them. Most notably, think of how John the Baptist is the last one in that line who has just been murdered in Mark chapter 6. And with the tenants not listening to the servants, the owner decides to send someone who has the owner's authority, his own son. Verse 6, he had still one other, a beloved son. Finally, he sent him to them, saying, they will respect my son. But those tenants said to one another, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. The tenants see the son coming and seize on a selfish opportunity, thinking that if the son is here, then the owner must be out of the picture. That's why they refer to the son as the heir. And if the son dies and no one knows about it, then typically in these days, the vineyard would have been given to the tenants. It's the classic power grab. Continue in verse 8. And they took him and killed him and threw him out of the vineyard. What will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the tenants and give the vineyard to others. In Matthew's account of this parable, we're told that the religious leaders are the ones who answer Jesus' question in verse 9. And in Mark, we see Jesus is answering the question himself. Both those things happened. It's like when I ask one of my kids, who was the first president of the United States? They would say, George Washington. And then I would say, George Washington. See, I'm repeating what the answer is just to show that it's correct. And Jesus is agreeing with the response of these leaders by saying it back to them. And then notice, he says he will give the vineyard to others. Others is referring to other people besides these religious leaders who will be in charge of cultivating Israel in the future. So what happens here is that the kingdom of God is being taken away from this generation of Israel, represented by its leaders, because of the fact that they rejected Jesus as the Son of God. And notice, God's not getting rid of the vineyard altogether. He's saying the job of overseeing it is being taken away from them. And one day, after the second coming of Jesus, the apostles in their resurrected bodies will have the role of supervising Israel with Jesus in the millennial kingdom. We know this because of what Jesus says to his disciples in Matthew 19:28, letting them know that they will sit on the 12 thrones and judge the 12 tribes of Israel in the new kingdom. So this hasn't happened yet, but the apostles will be given the position of overseeing the future believing generation of Israel that is coming in the end times. Then Jesus drives home this point even further with verse 10 and 11. He says, have you not read this scripture? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Here, the builders are the religious leaders, and the stone that was rejected is Jesus. Jesus is the only way you can build the building. Remove him as the cornerstone, and it all comes crumbling down. So even if you teach the Torah or teach the prophets and try to keep the law of the Lord, but reject Jesus, then you've missed the whole thing. This is why you have to be so careful to examine what cornerstone you're building your life on. And it may not be instantly obvious to you, but the question is, are you building your life on anything else but Jesus? I'm going to share with you a short list of things that can compete for that cornerstone spot that only Jesus should have. I'm calling it three cornerstones that will fail you. Number one, your good behavior. Now, don't get me wrong. I often pray that God would change my behavior and the way I deal with things. But my point is, you can't make behavioral change the center of your walk with Jesus. God went out of his way to express that we look at the outward appearance, but he looks straight at the heart. God wants your heart. And if he has your heart, then over time, your behavior will change. But that will be the fruit of your relationship with Jesus, not the root or the foundation of your walk with Jesus. Remember, since you didn't earn your right standing with God in the first place, you can't unearn it either. Focus on placing Jesus at the center, and all these other things will begin to line up. Number two, your opinions. Another subtle replacement for knowing Jesus can be knowing about Jesus. God calls us to love him with our mind, and I'm all in on that. But there is also the warning in Scripture that knowledge puffs up, meaning information can trigger pride. So if information about Jesus and the Bible is the vast majority of your walk with Jesus, then something's wrong. If knowing the Bible was the end game, then some people would already be basically fully sanctified. But there's a whole lot more than knowledge when it comes to following Jesus. That's why a relationship with him has to be at the center, not just knowledge of him. And finally this, number three, and I have to say this because it comes most closely out of this passage, and that's your leaders. Your leaders aren't the cornerstone. And I'm just using this as a broad term for all the leaders God has placed over you. Yes, there is a purpose God is accomplishing through them, but God accomplishes those purposes through their correct and incorrect decisions. I mean, just look at the mess in the Old Testament, and yet God continues to work it all together for his plans. So the next time the person you voted for doesn't win the election, or the next time you're disappointed in a response you got from a pastor, or the next time you see someone in ministry have to leave ministry altogether, just remember, you still have Jesus. And if Jesus is the cornerstone, then things might feel a bit shaky at times, but you're not going to crumble. You may be struck down, but you won't be destroyed. If Jesus is given his rightful place as the cornerstone, then those three things can have their rightful place in your life. I'm not saying get rid of them. I'm saying put them in the right spot. That's why nothing is more important than you cultivating your personal relationship with Jesus. As you learn from the Bible and spend time talking to him in prayer, you're building upon him as the cornerstone of your life. And our passage ends with verse 12 that says, "And they were seeking to arrest him, but feared the people, for they perceived that he had told a parable against them. So they left him and went away." This concludes this scene of the tension that is rising between Jesus and the religious leaders. And as you will notice, it's all surrounding his authority. Since Jesus is the Messiah, it requires us to acknowledge that all authority belongs to him because it was given to him from God the Father. And our sinful bent is to not want to give him that authority in our lives. Maybe what's behind your cynicism towards the Bible is your unwillingness to submit to God's authority. Or maybe you want to focus on crowd control or people-pleasing instead of the truth that Jesus has spoken. Because when you hear his words, you have to submit to his authority. Submitting to Jesus' authority is something we should do gladly, because you are in the safest place when you are in his care. God doesn't lord his authority over you like some earthly dictator. He wants you to submit to his authority because he knows what's best. And in submission to him, you will find the greatest joy and peace and rest. So to close today, I ask you this question. Are you submitting to the authority of Jesus? I know it's super unpopular to submit to authorities these days, and we live in the times of me and my thoughts and my opinions. But is there an area in your life where you know what Jesus commands, and yet you're pushing it aside? Hear me. That path only leads towards pain for you. And in God's grace, here we are today with an opportunity for you to choose to submit to Jesus' authority. So to apply this week, here's my challenge for you. First, think of the answer to this question. Out of all the things it has meant for you to follow Jesus, what is the area that is hardest for you? It's going to be different for each one of us. What's the area that's hardest for you? No judgment. I just want an honest answer to that question. You have your answer? All right. Well, once you have your answer, I want to invite you to share that with your closest brother or sister in Christ this week. One of God's provisions of encouragement for you is his church. And in this time when we are physically apart, this is a simple way for us to be spiritually close. I'm committing to making that phone call by the end of today. So make your phone call this week and share with your brother or sister what's going on in your life in regards to following Jesus. Because he's the only one that we follow here in this church. He's the only one that we praise. Just Jesus.
Oh, behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. Behold.
Pastor Eddie for us today. I don't know, what is the area that's the hardest for you to follow Jesus in? Get together with a friend. Talk it over with them and ask God to show up in a big way, in a mighty way, and that you can see progress in your life beginning as quick as today or this week. Hey, there's no need for you to rush away today. If you are on our website and you'd like to have a little time of prayer with some of our staff, all you have to do is click live prayer. If you're on Facebook or YouTube, I'd invite you just to go to the link in the comment section and click on that, and one of our staff will be there to connect with you and pray with you. Hey students, before you leave today, just know that summer ministry is beginning for you this week. Go to harveststudents.org for more details. Well, it's been so great to have you join us online today. I trust you'll have a great week, and know this, you are loved.